Hi, this is COMP1010 at the University of Manitoba. I'm Dr. Celine LaTulip, and today I'm going to be walking you through some examples of using arrays in processing. So let's get started. We switch into processing. Let's first look at the drawstrings example. So in this example, what we have is an array called words, and it is set up as a literal array. So we've got the curly braces and we have a whole bunch of strings. So the type of this array is a string array. You can see that right here. And we've got a bunch of different words in here that are strings that are separated by commas. So this is a quick test of an array with a bunch of words in it. Hello, bonjour, friend, computer science, awesome, Manitoba, Winnipeg, dogs and cats. So that's the words in our array. And right now we have set up a canvas. We've decided that we want some black text and we want our text to be fairly big. And now our job is to actually print these words out randomly on the canvas. So we're going to do this. So the way that we're going to do this is we're going to loop through and iterate across each item in the array. So we'll write a for loop and we will iterate through from I equals zero until we've got to the end of this array. So words is an array, so we can find out that by getting the length. And as long as we do I less than length, we're going to be fine because we don't want to do less than or equal to length because we don't want to index into the number of words in the array. That would give us an array out of bounds error. And we increment I. And now in here, what we want to do is get two random values for where we're going to put the word. So float x equals random. And we want to go from the left side of the screen up to the right side of the screen. But we don't really, so what should we put here? We would normally put width, but if we have a long word and we actually start the word at width, most of the word would be off the right side of the screen. So we need this to be width minus something. And so now we need to know how long is our word? What is the length of it? So if we do text width, then we can get the width of our word, but we need to actually pass in our word. So here's where we're going to actually get something out of the array. So we're going to call words because that's the name of our array. And we're going to say for the word that we're on right now, which is I. So this will find out how long the word we're on is, subtract it from width, and we pass zero and that number to random, and that will give us an x value. For the y, we want this to be a random value between, we don't want quite zero because we don't want the text to be off the top of the screen, so we need to use text ascent because that's the sort of the height down to the baseline of where the text starts. And then we need height, and we also want to make sure it doesn't go off the bottom of the screen. So we'll subtract text descent just to make sure that if there's any below line character pieces that they're still on screen. Okay, so now we've got our X and our Y and we can print out our text. And now what is our text? Well, this is where we index into the array, words of I, and then our x and our y value. And we close off our for loop. And so what's going to happen here is we're going to start at zero and we're going to, that will give us the first word, the word that's in the first slot, which is this. It will figure out how big this is, subtract that from width to make sure that we don't get a random value that would cause this to not be shown. And then here we're actually printing out, we're getting it again. So we're printing out this at these x, y coordinates that we've calculated. And then as we iterate through our loop, I is going to become one, and then we're going to get the length of is, and we're going to print out is, and then I will become two. We'll get the length of and print out etc. So this will allow us to get through all of these words, and for each one, find out the length of it to make sure that we're keeping it on screen, and then print that word out. Okay, so let's run it. And here's our words randomly drawn all over the screen. Okay. And if we wanted to do something interesting, we could randomly change the colors of these words, that type of thing. We won't bother with that right now, but let's run it again just to see that again, We get a random mishmash of words. And so our last word in this array is cats. And you always want to check to make sure that you're getting the whole array processed. And here indeed is the word cats. So this works pretty well. All right, so let's look at another example. Let's look at statistics. Okay, so the statistics example is actually fully coded here. We're just going to walk through it. And so in this example, what we are doing is we are going to prompt the user for a number. So we want to prompt the user for a number to say, how many values are you going to give us? And then we're going to prompt the user that many times and get them to enter a number. And then we're going to store those numbers in an array and calculate some statistics and print them out. So let's just look through this code. And I'm going to zoom in just so it's really visible. So first of all, we have to import the JOption pane so that we can actually prompt the user. We have a variable up here called numDataValues. And so we are calling JOption pane and asking the user, how many data values do you have? That will return a string, but we are actually passing that into the int function so that we get a number. So hopefully the user actually types in something that's a number. We're not doing any data validation here. And then after we know how many data values the user is going to give us, then we can actually create an array. So here we are allocating reference variable called data values that can point to any float array. And here we're actually creating a float array. So we've got our new keyword, the array is of type float, and we're saying here's how many slots we need. And that's based on what the user told us, right? Then we're going to go through and fill in the array with data values. So this for loop loops through from 0 up to the number of data values. And right now, the data or data values array will have default values, which are all 0.0, but we want to get values from our user. So we're going to prompt our user numDataValues times. We're going to ask them to give us a value. And this time we're actually passing it into the float function to make sure that we're casting it to a float before assigning it into our array. And this will enable the user to enter a number like 3.7 and we'll actually get it as a float. Once we've done this, and this is going to loop through the number of times that we have slots in the array, once we've done this, we're going to calculate some statistics. So let's actually just look at the interaction first, and then we'll come back and look at the statistics calculation. So if we run this, it asks me, how many values do you have? I'm going to say 3 just to keep it fast. And then I'm going to enter 4.9. Okay. And I'm going to enter 7. Okay. And I'm going to enter 2.1. Okay. And so this finished. And if we look down here, we can see that we got the numbers printed out. So here's the numbers that I entered. They're stored in the array. 4.9 is in the first slot, 7.0 is in the second slot, and 2.1 is in the third slot. These are indexed by 0, 1, and 2. And then we've got these statistics calculated. So let's go now and look at how this works in terms of the calculating the statistics. So we want to know the sum, how much the different values all add up to. So we have to create a variable to hold that. We initialize it to 0.0 and it's going to be a float. We want to know what the smallest value the user entered is and what the largest value the user entered is. So we're going to create min and max. And what we're going to do just to start off is we're going to assign each of these to the first value in the array. So this right here says, go to our array, go into the first slot because that's indexed by 0, get that value, copy it out, and assign it into min. And this one is going to do the same thing. We're going to get the exact same value. We're going to copy it into max. So this is just our way to start off. If it turns out that this number is not the smallest value, then we'll assign it to something else. So now we're going to iterate through our array. So we have int I equals 0. We're going from I equals 0 up to I less than numDataValues. And we're incrementing by 1. So this is a very standard header for going through an array. Sometimes we might actually use, instead of, we have this variable that actually tells us how many slots we have, but this could also be data values dot length, right? So either way, it just happens that we have a variable that tells us how many data values there are. which is num data values. So you can do either thing here. So now what we're going to do is we're going to add to our sum the value that's in each element. So we're going to first look and get the value that's in at index 0. We're going to add it to the sum. And we'll do that for each one as we go through. Then we're going to check to see, is the data value that we're currently at less than our current min value? So remember, min right now holds the value that's in the first slot. So the first time we go through here, we're actually going to be comparing the same piece of data to min because it's the same. It won't be less than, so we won't bother. But if we get to the second value and our second value is actually less than what was in the first slot, then we do another assignment and we say, okay, so min should actually be what's in this second slot. And the same thing here for the max. This time we want to check, is the value that we're currently at as we iterate through the array bigger than the max that we currently have? If it is, then we need to assign that value to max, which is what we're doing on this line. So we iterate through the array, we look at every value, we're adding it to the sum, we're checking to see if it's less than our current min, we're checking to see if it's greater than our current max, making assignments if it is. And then at the end, we do one calculation, which is to calculate the average, which is simply the sum over the number of data values. And then we're printing out the results. So here we print out the whole array, here we print out our min, here we print out our max, we print out the sum, and we print out the average. So now that you've seen how that works, let's go through and run this one more time. Okay, so let's put in 5 values this time, and we'll do 9.2 and 5.4 and 17.5 and 87.6. And we'll actually do a negative number, -6.1. Okay. And if we look down here, we increase this up, then we can see what our values are. So here's the numbers that I just was prompted to type in. The min value is that lowest value, the negative number. The max value is the 87.6. The sum of the values is this, and the average of the values is that. So hopefully that gives you a good idea of some of the ways that we can iterate through arrays and do calculations with those numbers. And that's about it for this example. Thanks for watching.